toy soldier war chest panel here at San Diego Comic Con 2015. I'm Greg Miller, and the question I have is, how many people have been to a Comic-Con panel before? If you raise your hand, you've been to bad Comic-Con panels. Let's get something straight right here. Comic-Con's all about energy, and fandom, and craziness. So when I ask questions to the audience, you need to clap, cheer, or boo. So if I was to say, who loves He-Man? And then if I was to say bad news like, Toy Soldiers has been delayed until 2019, you guys know what's up. You guys know. Don't raise your hands. Stop it, Nick. Thank you. Here, of course, my personal war chest for Toy Soldiers, a little lunchbox. If you go to the Assassin's Creed rigmarole across the street with a guy with a megaphone yelling at you and stuff, you can pre-order the game. 40 of these every day are given away with the first 40 pre-orders. They're pretty cool. I'm Greg Miller. My life's defined by video games. I don't know if you know that. It's the only thing I'm famous for, is talking about video games, which is a pretty sweet gig. One guy's a fan of me. Thank you, sir. Woo! Two fans. Woo! More fans? Woo! Well, then I'm not even talking about this video game anymore. Let's just talk, no. For me, I think, you know, my love of video games comes from my love of action figures, right? Because I played with action figures for far too long. I had a girlfriend in high school, first girlfriend, came over, I'm like, this is my room, these are my TV, this is my chest full of toys. And she was like, what? And I was like, yeah, I still buy DC Total Justice action figures. And like, don't worry about it. But video games became the evolution of that, and we got to sit down and play, you know, with these characters in these online worlds, in these giant sandbox games. And so that's why I think I love Toy Soldiers so much, right, is that it's full circle. It's He-Man. It's G.I. Joe. It's everybody you love put into a game world. But again, even though you all love me, which I appreciate quite a bit. You didn't come here to talk to me about this. So they gave me official introductions for the panel of experts you have, all right? So let me do this here. And without further ado, please welcome to the stage the creative minds behind your favorite action figures and video games, Hasbro's VP Global Brand Marketing and G.I. Joe historian, Derryl DePriest. Anywhere you want, you're the first one. Go all the way to the end. You can take the podium if you really want. Is Derryl? No, okay, fine. Then, Mattel's Director of Global Marketing and Franchise Development for Masters of the Universe, Mark Morse. Now here's where it's really comical, is that they had nice introductions for them. The next part says, etc. This is Josh Mast. Josh, come on up here. Josh is producer. Josh is making the game. And all he's put is a footnote of etc. How do you feel about that, Josh?
I think I can live with that because these guys are here.
They're more important. They are. That's what you're saying. Because that's the thing about being a developer, right? You hide behind the scenes. You make the game happen. Do all these different things. You help produce it. And then it comes out here and people want to know about He-Man. They want to know about G.I. Joe. Do you understand the long, sleepless night this man's put into this game? And the fact that there's hundreds just like him that'll never be on a Comic-Con panel with a world-renowned Twitter host. It's sad when you think about it. So, I think it really comes down to, Derryl, what the hell is a G.I. Joe historian?
Well, a number of years ago, I was fortunate enough to write a G.I. Joe book. So, it was on the original 12-inch G.I. Joes from the 60s and 70s that were primarily my childhood. So ever since that, when I came into Hasbro, actually as a marketer to take over G.I. Joe, I automatically came in with all the baggage of being like the world's most knowledgeable G.I. Joe historian, which as you guys know, Fran and Phil, you know that's not necessarily true for G.I. Joe Cobra, but since then I've learned and embraced all of it. So it's a great thing to be known as, because it means I'm deep and passionate, you know, in G.I. Joe lore, just like you guys, so.
When you think about like, your life and how it ties into G.I. Joe, like, is it possible, like, if I was to say, what's your, like, greatest memory from G.I. Joe, does it go back to you playing with the toys, or does it come to, like, present day where you help broker a G.I. Joe deal?
Oh, well, it's a little bit of both. So, I grew up playing, I have two younger brothers, and literally under the Christmas tree every year, were three of the identical G.I. Joe things, because we, even though we played together, we couldn't share the same toy. We each had to have the toy. So our house was a G.I. Joe house to the core, and it was just, we had three of everything. And over time, one of my fondest memories is I actually accumulated their collections into mine. So it's three times as big as anybody ought to have, just because I have all their stuff too. But it translates over into, you know, my professional life too. So I'm very lucky to have something I'm deeply passionate about and get to, you know, do that on a day-to-day basis. And some of the greatest memories are relaunching the brand and being able to, you know, recruit personally Dwayne Johnson to be Roblox, you know, for the last film. So, you know, it doesn't get cooler and more amazing than that.
Now, Mark. Switching over to Masters of the Universe, I like that you're officially listed as Director of Global Marketing and Franchise Development for Masters of the Universe at Mattel.
It's a mouthful to fit on a card.
How is the franchise developing? Do you think this Masters of the Universe has legs?
It might stick around for a couple more years. No, it's fantastic. It's been around since 82, and I think, you know, we have such passionate fans that are very eager to correct me whenever I get things wrong about the brand.
Yeah. Round of applause. Who was playing with Masters of the Universe in 82, 83?
Hey, everybody, we're really old. We are old people.
But now they're in video games, so again, it's socially acceptable. But anyways, so, Mark, for you then, I mean, talk a little bit about, like, how long have you been in this position, and for you, like, what's your greatest memory? Is it you playing with these toys back in the day, or is it now the fact that you get to bring them to new generations?
It's a little bit of both. For me, it was the show. It was that animated show, and I remember every day before school, having breakfast and juice in my Empire Strikes Back Burger King glass, and watching that show before going off to fifth grade, you know? And then to be working on the brand so many years later, and to be able to bring it to life and the high-end collectibles that we're able to do on Madden Collector and things like that, it's so cool to be able to keep working on this brand.
Yeah. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I know you have a lot of questions for this panel of experts. There's a couple ways to be part of the show. You can be just lazy, tweet at Toy Soldiers Game. Then over there we have a team of Ubisoft social media experts. Do you see her pumping her fists? Keep pumping it. CC, that's CC. She'll be going up to Twitter finding great questions. Then over here, I have two idiots from kindoffunny.com, Tim and Nick Scarpino. They have a bowl. They have a bowl, and some of you should have note cards. There's the note cards in the pants. So if you want, they're going to wander around. You can flag them down, grab a card, write it, toss it in the chalice. Flagging them down, there you go, sir. Keep doing it, Nick. That's how you got to push it. Push it on somebody, Nick. Get a question from somebody.
Are they allowed to raise their hands?
You're allowed to raise your hand if you have a question you want to write it in the card.
Okay. Or,
there's a lot. It's a developing panel. Don't worry. Don't worry. Spread out. Why are you all bunched up?
Over here.
See, there you go. Over there, they're saying. Jeez. You know what I mean? I have to work with these people every day. It's bad in there. So, Derryl, they come to you with this idea. We want to put G.I. Joe into this universe, into that. Is that a no-brainer? To get G.I. Joe involved? I mean, what's happening with the G.I. Joe franchise right now?
Yeah, so right now, I can't give you too many details, but obviously Paramount has a very successful global franchise with their G.I. Joe movies. We are, you know, working with them and talking with them about what's going to come next. Don't have any details on that, but that kind of sets overall what our kind of activity roadmap is. So, you know, we work around our big stories when the entertainment happens, and in between years, we celebrate the fan, we celebrate the toys, the heritage of G.I. Joe. So right now we have we're still continuing our 50th anniversary overall G.I. Joe celebration, some fantastic products with Toys R Us. And you can check that out. IDW has their comics, and we're doing some very special, cool things like this game with Ubisoft.
That was a lot of marketing speak. Where is Sergeant Slaughter? Where is Sergeant Slaughter? I need him here now. Give the people what they want.
So, okay, the next film is actually going to be about.
Oh, good. All right, great. Mark, I mean, similar question for you guys. Masters of the Universe. They come, you know, Ubisoft comes to you, they want to put He-Man, they want to get everything involved. It is Masters of the Universe. Are you guys like, yeah, great idea, go for it, or is there more to do because there's something else happening? As you develop this burgeoning franchise.
Right. It was one of those things that the pitch for this game in particular, we've been approached about He-Man games in the past, Masters games in the past, and the take on this one, I think, is what made it so perfect, because it was, how are the toys going to come to life? And, you know, that's every kid's fantasy and grown kid's fantasy too, which is what most of us are, right? Like, now here's a way. You were talking about your high school girlfriend, and I still doubt that is maybe a true story, or it was a very short-lived relationship. But
we weren't together much longer. It wasn't a good scene.
But now you can virtually play with your toys in this game. You can have them battle other toys that you had, which we all know is how kids play. You all have your armies fight each other. So when they came to us with this idea, it was, I mean, Josh, it was just a no-brainer for us. Yeah.
And now we come to you, Josh. I want to read back a quote Mark just said. Every kid's dream. No pressure. Like, what is it like to sit down and, like, where did the idea for the game come from? I mean, did you think you'd get Masters of the Universe G.I. Joe involved?
No, everyone thought I was crazy. But no, Toy Soldiers has been around for a couple of years now. It's a franchise that's developed by a team at Signal Studios, who are an independent developer. And they've done a really good job with it. It's been a specific game for the first two. And they had this idea for the third one, which was literally bringing all the toys you used to play with together, pitting them against one another. And so we had this idea, like, okay, if we can do the perfect, like, what's the perfect scenario we can do? And it was literally, if we can get G.I. Joe versus He-Man in a game like that, I would fulfill my entire childhood, right? It would all have been worth it. And so we had the idea, everyone thought I was crazy, but we pursued it, and yeah, came together, and I think it looks really cool.
So for now, you're talking about your idea, you did. This is how you came into it. What does a producer do on a video game like this, right? You think of a developer, you think of a dark cave, and they're coding, and there's lines, and it looks like the Matrix, I assume. What's your role in it? Are you the guy going to Daryl and Mark and being like, hey, can we work with you guys?
Yeah, a little bit of both. I mean, I live in the dark cave, too. Really, it's doing a little bit of everything, working with the engineers and the artists, getting stuff in the game and running and playing it, making sure it's fun, coming together. And then working with these guys to make sure, you know, we're true to the brand, they're happy with what we're doing as well, and really just sort of the person who's talking to everyone and bringing it all together and getting my hands dirty wherever it can help.
Okay. So here's my question, because I'll go into the crowd. That way it's a crowd question. So people, I didn't tweet, and I actually bring me the bucket and a note card. Please. As many people have been doing. All right, give me the note card, and I toss it in the bucket. All right, so my question is, when I first saw this, and they talk about it, you know, it's going to be armies, and it's going to be these characters going out. That's great, but for He-Man, for G.I. Joe, like, what does that mean? Like, who else is it? Like, how He-Man can't fight an entire army by himself. He could, of course. We all know how powerful.
Yeah, I think he'd do all right.
Could He-Man fight an entire army?
Yeah! Yeah.
Could Duke fight an entire army?
Yeah! Definitely.
So, I mean, who else is in this game? How does this work?
Yeah, so those are the heroes, right? And the way the game works, it's this sort of unique blend of an action meets strategy game. And so each of the heroes comes with an army of defensive placements and offensive waves and vehicles that they fight with. And so what that means is we've got a few characters from different brands that come together, but really it's just trying to take, we literally just went through our boxes of toys that we had when we were kids and just tried to find the coolest looking stuff and put it in the game. And it was again like bringing the toys to life, right? So as we go through them here, you can see the seams of the plastic, you can see the stickers that are on there. It's all, we tried to stay very authentic to what these looked like when we were kids and how we remembered playing with them.
Yes. Oh yeah, here they go. I'm excited for the He-Man room.
Yeah! Yeah, so of course, Battle Cats and everyone. So all the heroes have to be in here.
Where's She-Ra? Where's She-Ra?
Yeah, we hear you, audience, except right here on a note card. Go! Oh, yeah. So Josh, while we're looking at this, I think the main question that jumps to a lot of people's heads is, what the hell is this game? Because you say it's strategy, it's action, you see, you know, He-Man charges the field. What is the moment-to-moment gameplay like?
Yeah, so the moment-to-moment, it's really an action game at its heart. And we tried to, the way that the team at Signal did this, so they looked at a bunch of different games, tower defense games, MOBAs, third-person shooters, And as a standalone, each of those genres are pretty cool, we like them, but there's really, if we could pick like the best part of each of those genres and then smash them together, that's how Toy Soldiers came to be. And it was really like, strategy games are cool and building and placing turrets and turret defense is cool, but how cool would it be if you could actually take control of those turrets? Now it's a shooter and you could actually like shoot these toys and take care of it that way. And so that's really what makes Toy Soldiers a little bit different from a lot of the other games out there. It's all the stuff that you put out there on the battlefield that normally would just be, you know, AI will shoot for you, the turrets will defend your toy box, but you can also take control of all of it and just get right into the action.
So then, Mark and Derryl, but we'll start with Mark. When you're up there, you're seeing Match of the Universe, you're seeing He-Man and stuff. How much of a back and forth is there? Have you guys been like, well, He-Man looks good, but what about this or that? Like, are there changes or differences there?
Yeah, I think He-Man was pretty complicated, I think, because we started down one path, which was, okay, we want it to be like the original action figures. And those of you that know the original action figures know they don't move a lot. It's like a lot of points of articulation. So when they started making the models, we're like, maybe we can use the updated version to get 26 points of articulation? And we started going with that because they still are so true to what the originals were. But we made some compromises here and there, I think, where there's a kind of a blend of the two styles.
Yeah. Derryl, was that the same for G.I. Joe? Because yesterday at lunch, we sat down to rehearse, and you immediately pulled Josh aside, and we're like, you started going through a checklist. And I was like, damn, this is what a G.I. Joe historian is. Okay.
Right, exactly. No, so what's so unique about this game is because it does pay tribute to the toys, right? And I think, you know, one thing that G.I. Joe shared with He-Man is it started as a universe of toys first. So we needed to make sure that some certain, you know, internal consistency held. And going back and forth with Josh, it was very clear, as Josh and his team explained what the game was for us, that we were going to have to let them take a few of the liberties. So we actually let Ubisoft like redesign some of the installations that you guys might have seen some of them. Like the flat cannon is actually much larger than the original flat cannon, but that's on purpose. So we kind of think of it as, you know, flak 2.0, because the game needed a, you know, large anti-aircraft installation there. So what we did is the Ubisoft wanted to be very true to the toys, but wanted to have flexibility. And we were all about that, giving them the ability to kind of like reinterpret some of the classic designs. But they were so amazingly, you know, true to the original design and spirit of the toys. And we just fell under the spell. I mean, this is a super cool thing that if you grew up playing G.I. Joe, you know, you are really gonna feel like a kid again back in your backyard. So much to the extent that yesterday at lunch, I was saying, Josh, is there a way that, you know, you could get some broken thumbs on the figures in there? I mean, this is so lifelike. Broken thumbs, maybe a broken crotch here and there, you know. You joke collectors know what I mean about that. But it's awesome and it's true. And working with Josh and the team has been a fantastic process because they love it and want to get it right. So it's just like our toys come to life.
We actually had a throughout development, we had a great box. Like all the people, like all those years of collecting action figures were like finally worth it, right? So everyone brought in all their toys, had their parents, they shipped us out all our stuff from like our childhood homes. And so we had like literally just a crate of just pieces, like arms and legs that had fallen off over the years. And one of the animators at Signal actually, he's so into it that he spent, you know, weeks of his free time and weekend just going through this box and literally put them all back together, you know, put new rubber bands in there and rebuild
them. Free time and weekends, yes.
Not while I'm supposed to make a game, I'm sure.
Crazy talk. Ladies and gentlemen, from what you've seen and heard, are you excited about Toy Soldiers? Don't raise your hands, sir. Clap and cheer. Huh. What if I told you they brought no exclusive footage and no announcements? They wouldn't do that. All right. So guys, so far we have these six people up here, these six armies, these six factions. You have two more to announce today, correct?
That's right.
Do you want to see them? Yeah! Do you want to break news? Yeah! Roll the footage. Now, Silent Bob. And then earlier today, I pulled aside Ubisoft PR, and I'm like, I'm not forgetting the He-Man character named Ezio, am I right? It's Assassin's Creed? That's pretty cool. I mean, why did these guys fit, Josh? Why did you need to get these guys in?
Oh, that was the dream, right? Like, again, the sort of way this all started is, like, if we can get G.I. Joe versus He-Man, that's the dream. But then we started to think about it, like, well, really, we had way more toys than that. It wasn't any specific, you know, universe when we were kids. It was just every toy we had was all fighting in these battles we made up, right? So it was like, I had my sister's toys, I had my brother's toys, and my toys, and they all fought the same army. So that was the idea with the war chest, to just put everything we could get into the game and try to get as close as we could to those battles we fought when we were kids and what we were thinking in our imagination when we were playing.
Derryl, as the G.I. Joe historian, I was wondering if you could give me your best Cobra Commander Cobra yell.
Cobra!
That about sums it all up, I guess. So then, Derryl, the whole, you know, Cobra, G.I. Joe, like, for you, you're talking about broken thumbs, you're talking about busted pelvises, like, what are the things that they had to nail? Like, what is the stuff for these franchises that had to be there to make it feel real?
So, well, there's a lot. A lot of it is, you know, what's great about the game is it anticipates ground attack, air attack, and that's basically how the G.I. Joe line was constructed to begin with. It was all the tactical solutions to wage a giant fantasy war, and Ubisoft was able to draw in elements out of all of that. So you see a lot of that, and it starts with bunkers and installations. You saw, like, with G.I. Joe, you have the watchtower. With Cobra, you have the battle bunker. That's kind of like your base installation. What's really cool, I will tell you, you saw a little bit of that in the clip. It's how Ubisoft kind of recreated how those things, like work and go together. So they added a lot of cool thinking with how, you know, I guess they would be functional military things for a small-scale unit. But you're gonna see awesome Cobra and Joe vehicles, but Cobra in particular has the Asp and the Rattler, and the air carrier from the TV show is in there, which we've never seen really in any form before, so it's appearing for the very first time. So it's like a super, really well-rounded versions. And my favorite character that's in there is gonna be the Bat Trooper, the Battle Android Trooper with, he'll have reconfigurable arms that he's gonna be able to bring out in battle. It's just super cool. It's so true to the toy experience that we all grew up under, but we thought, you know, for today in a game environment.
Yeah, we actually, the funny thing is when we started all this, we're like, oh, we should be able to nail G.I. Joe and He-Man. It'd be super easy. We'll get all this great reference from these guys. We'll get 3D models and stuff, and perfect. And it didn't dawn on us at the time that these things were created in the 80s, right? They didn't have 3D software to make these. These existed in, like, vaults in the bottom of these guys' headquarters and stuff. And so we were getting this reference, and they had a lot of scans and things of boxes. But as it turns out, you guys, the fans, provided the best reference. Because as it turns out, eBay has very high-res photos of very detailed shots of every toy ever made. So we ended up getting a lot of, like, scans of the sticker sheets so we could put that stuff straight in the game and try to stay enough pretty close to it.
So then for Mark, I mean, for Masters of the Universe, other than bangs, what do they need to nail? Like, what do they have to nail in terms of characteristics?
Bangs were very high.
Yeah, that's got to be He-Man hair, number one.
I think it was capturing just all of the detail of the different characters, because the characters are so distinct in that universe. And I love the fact that you can have, you know, an army of Trollins, just all these orcos floating around doing damage and things like that. Although I take umbrage with the Assassin's Creed characters destroying them a bit in that trailer there, so we might have to talk there.
It's too late, you signed the contract.
I know. But it's, you know, Eternian guards and man-at-arms commanding an army and stuff like that. It's just so magical to watch these come to life and to be able to, you know, digitally play with these toys and not have them take up so much space in your home. I think it's a benefit for all of the wives and ladies. So
Josh, I mean, when I play with my He-Man toys, my G.I. Joes, right, they're mainly banging together and I'm making sounds like, what are the characteristics you put in this game? Like, I mean, how do you choose, or what do you put in the game, you know, like, effects that make this feel like it's more than Greg Miller being fat, slamming toys together?
Yeah, we'll give you the voices for the next one.
Oh, good. I'm there for sound effects.
So we, like, again, trying to capture that stuff we did as kids. Like, I think most of us, maybe it's just me, but, like, as kids, we're, you know, tying firecrackers to our toys and, you know, using laser pointers and stuff to pretend to melt them. We wanted to capture that feeling in there, too. So, like, with the defensive units in the game, you know, there's some strategy elements to toy soldiers, and so you upgrade your turrets and they get stronger. And so there's this big question about like how do you upgrade toys?
Stop. Is this? I feel lost in this. Like, is this? Can we see the game? Would it be possible to break? Oh!
So when you upgrade damage, like what does that mean if you upgrade the damage of a G.I. Joe toy? Because as kids, that meant like strapping a battery to the side and taking a laser pointer on it. And so that's what we ended up doing in the game. Like when you upgrade the damage of some of these guns, you have literally those kids like a tape laser pointer on the side. And then you have alt fire where you can now shoot a laser from that machine gun. And so again, like just trying to take all this weird stuff and see these kids and capture that moment and put it in the game stuff that we can play. Here, this cobra's running around, right? So the way the game works is as you're playing and defending your toy box here, you're trying to stop the waves of enemies from getting into your toy box. There's aerial units, ground units, vehicles. As you build up action points and play the game, you can call in and drop your hero into battle. And as you may have seen it here, you'll see it again. It's literally the, like the blister pack drops into the game field, and you can jump out and you can take control of the heroes. And all the heroes have different weapon loadouts. They have different items available to them. This is a shot of multiplayer that we're showing here. So the way the different loadouts work for multiplayer, we're like, what does a tower defense multiplayer game even look like? And a big part of that is like, if you could build a wave list that you send against your opponent, that'd be pretty cool. So that's what we did. So it's, you're on opposite sides of the battlefield and you choose the units that you're gonna send and in which order they're gonna launch. And then you take turns attacking, defending, and trying to defend off the enemy. And wait, you see a line in the middle that's not a bug. That's actually, we took, what ended up happening for most players, we took the playsets and literally just chopped them in half and slammed them together. So, it's as if you pulled your two playsets and put them together and they're having this battle over the turf in the middle of it.
What I love about this is it looks like the kind of playsets the kids hatch in commercials.
Remember that? We watch these kids run around and they have like smoke effects. You're like, damn, Dad, can you build me a moat in the back? He's like, no. Okay, I bought you the toy. Give me another beer. You're like, oh, Dad!
Fire on, Joe!
And you'll see, so the rooms are pretty true to, I think, how we felt your arts. Boxes and the cards are super cool. And so the rooms, like to your point, Greg, you can see in the background, there's like literally just a bag of sand. So in our mind, in this world, right, the kids like brought the sandbag into their bedroom, dumped it on the floor, and made these places.
Rich kids, I hate them. Now, I know in the audience, I know I'm the host, so you would have expected me to see this already. I'm not crazy, I haven't seen it. This looks awesome, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That sounds cool.
And
now you're watching like, damn.
And so He-Man are a little different, right? So obviously He-Man doesn't have a lot of guns that he uses. So it doesn't really fit with how Toy Soldiers has been, which has been primarily a shooter game.
Mark, look away from the screen, Mark. I don't want you to see this.
The only guns He-Man needs are on his arms.
So the team up at Signal spent a lot of time putting a more in-depth melee system in the game primarily for He-Man, because everyone wants to dash about the field with He-Man and slice up the enemies. So he has a more melee-based army, so although they're all sort of equal as far as gameplay goes, they can all take care of the threats, they all play really differently. He-Man plays totally different from Duke, he plays different from Kaiser. It's all unique units and all different gameplay.
I love the details that you guys put in with little trading cards and VHS tapes of the episodes just lying around the battlefield and stuff. It's so cool.
Those assassins are like, oh god, it's He-Man.
Keep shooting him, but he's gonna get us. He's going around this.
So Josh, we're showing multiplayer. Talk to me a little bit about it. I'm assuming one-on-one online.
We're showing one-on-one online here. We also have two versus two for the first time. So now you can team up with a friend, split screen on your couch and play against someone else online, or you can get four people on their own consoles and play online that way too. And everything that works in multiplayer as far as online also works co-op, so you can play co-op with your friends in a single-player campaign. That again on the couch with your buddies, so you can play online. defend it the best you can.
That's awesome. Woo! Thanks, Nick. Thanks for the 50 minutes. I would have seen it. You didn't have to yell at me. Break up my entire flow. How do you think the panel's going so far?
It's great.
Yeah, me too.
It's
great. Yeah, enjoy this. How do you guys like it? It wouldn't be a Comic-Con panel without giveaways. So what I need, and this is the only chance you're allowed to raise your hand. Nobody raised their hands yet. I need, who thinks they would do really well at He-Man trivia? Yeah. Whoa! I saw one tentative hand do this and then go back down over there. You got one? All right, come up here. Or Nick, take him to the microphone in the center. You're in charge. So He-Man, or Mr. He-Man, I'm sorry, I don't want to address you on a first name basis. Mr. He-Man, follow Nick to that microphone. Anybody else want to take a shot at He-Man trivia? You're trying? I like it. Go over there with Nick as well. Now, I need a show of hands for G.I. Joe trivia. I saw these two right here, Cobra and the white shirt. So you guys go over there to Nick as well. Sir in the hat. Hat man behind you, Nick. Pat him on the shoulder nicely. Pat him on the shoulder nicely. We didn't call him. He has to sit down. I'm sorry, I don't. Aw. Don't boo me, boo him, everyone. Boo him. Now cheer!
Yeah!
I'll tell you what, Hatman. I'll give you this. They didn't tell me if I could or not, but I'm giving it to you anyway. How about that? Is that good enough? Come get it, Hatman. Cheer, Hatman, everyone. Here you go, sir. All right, well, we'll see. If they miss it, you can be the alternate for Masters of the Universe questions, okay?
Better hide it.
All right, perfect. All right, so which trivia question we start with, the He-Man or G.I. Joe?
G.I. Joe.
We're starting with the G.I. Joe. You got me a G.I. Give me one of the G.I. Joe guys. Give me Cobra.
Cobra.
Nick, who do we have over there?
Nice. We have Stan. And Stan is from San Diego.
Stan is from San Diego. A local boy. Look at Nick hold the microphone. All right.
What do you got?
Hi, are you confident you're gonna get this thing?
Extremely
confident. Your question is, who was the first member of the G.I. Joe team to be available exclusively by mail order? Was it A. Duke, B. Flint, C. Tripwire?
It's gotta be Duke.
It's gotta be Duke, you said. Audience, how do we feel about the Duke? How do we feel about Flint?
Yeah.
How do we feel about Tripwire? Huh? And the answer is? Yeah! So what do we have here?
This is a G.I. Joe Creo. Construction Commander's Complete Collection.
Later, we can get that sign on Saturday.
Now I see we're moving on to congratulations. Second Catman, Cobra, Stan from San Diego. Oh, look at his girlfriend's so proud of him. White? I'm sorry, I don't have the best eyes. What? Okay, all right, I'm wearing glasses.
She can't hear you from her shirt.
Oh, you know what I mean, Nick?
I do.
Thank you.
I really do.
Now we're moving on to a Masters of the Universe question. This is Mr. He-Man here. What's Mr. He-Man's name?
Lane from La Jolla.
Lane from La Jolla?
Yeah, La Jolla.
La Jolla.
It's a place in San Diego.
La Jolla Jackson?
Yes.
Gotcha. All right, question for you from the Masters of the Universe. Which famous actor from the TV series Friends made their motion picture debut in the 1987 cinematic masterpiece? Oh, we're throwing that around literally. Okay. Masters of the Universe. Was it A, Matt LeBlanc? B, Courtney Cox? C, Chicago's own David Schwimmer?
It would be Courtney Cox.
How do we feel about audience? How do we feel about A? Oh, we're saying Courtney Cox. We're just running with it. All right. And the answer is Courtney Cox. What do we got now, Tim?
A bunch of little things, a few pretty cool, and a hover robot.
Comic-Con exclusive! What else?
We got a motuscle, little dude.
Yeah.
Then there's a coin. It's a skeleton token.
That'll get you into our pop-up shop.
Tim, you got the harder job, didn't you, Tim?
We're a little airy.
Well, it just dawned on me, you know, I'm making Tim explain what everything is, and not all the experts over here. sorry. Well, you had them over. Here's what you do. You bring them up to the experts, and then they can walk. No, bring them back. Now I'm giving you this. God, Tim. You know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying.
Nick, how do you even have a business in this
business? I'm surprised he can read, to be perfectly honest. Thing, his skill set he currently has.
Mark, what are we giving away?
We're giving away our convention exclusives and then the freebies that we're handing out in the booth, which are the Skeletokens, which I don't know if you've heard about this, but we got a pop-up shop in the Gaslamp District, so this will get you admission into that. Ooh. If you want a coin, swing by the booth. A little muscle guy, Skeletor in purple, the only place you can get him in purple. And last but not least, we have a Stinkor air freshener. If you want to clear a room, open the bag. That's all I'm going to say.
All right, moving on to a G.I. Joe question. Who, Mr. White Shirt?
It's Fran.
It's Fran.
Philadelphia.
Fran from Philadelphia. Yeah. Philly! Yeah. Did you ever go to an ECW show? I always wanted to, but I was a kid when he's. Anyway, your G.I. Joe question is, G.I. Joe relaunched at the 3.75 scale in 1982. Which member of the original Carbon Joes was the only one to come without a weapon? Was it A, Breaker, B, Scarlet, or C, Flash? Fran, what do you think? Hold on, let's help them out. Audience, do you think it was A, Breaker? Do you think it was B, Scarlet?
Yeah.
Do you think it was C, Flash? Oh, it seems like people are confident in the A's a little bit.
Yeah, I'm going with Breaker.
You're going with Breaker A? And the answer is... A, Breaker! Woo! That was a close call. Come on, sir. You're in another one of the... Now, Daryl, again, explain what this is, as you're the expert.
So this is our newest Creo G.I. Joe set. As everybody, most Joe fans know, Sergeant Slaughter is one of the two real-life personalities to be part of the Joe team back in the 80s. The other one was William the Refrigerator Perry. So we have worked with Sarge to produce this super cool set. It looks like a VHS box set. It's exclusively available at the booth at Hasbro Toy Shop, only available here and a limited number online. So come and check it out. And it's really, we have a chance to work with Sarge. It's like every, you know, solar eclipse every 7 years. So this is, will be our chance for a while. So it's an awesome set. Come check it out.
Awesome.
We actually did Sergeant Slaughter in the game in an early build. He was like, yeah, Sergeant Slaughter's awesome. And then the guys over there took a look at it and they was like, he's a real person. You can't.
Sarge would love it, I'm sure. Nick.
Yes, Kurt.
It's time for our final question. Masters of the Universe question. Who do we have now?
Troy from Chula Vista.
Chula Vista. Thank you. I enjoyed, I looked out here. I needed a hero.
Yes.
And you stood up.
Thank you.
That's what Comic Con's all about. Round of applause for
him. I hope I read it right. I have this show with my son and he's growing up, so.
I see what you're saying. You got it through osmosis.
Yes.
All right, great. What is the final trivia question? Everybody knows that Prince Adam says the word, Bubba Pop! I'm just auditioning, by the way, just letting you know. Available for you. To turn into He-Man. But what does He-Man say to turn back into Prince Adam in your best He-Man voice? Oh. A. The power is in me. B. I feel the power. C. Let the power return. Now, audience, it's time to help her out. Do we feel confident in A, the power is in B? Do we feel confident in B, I feel the power? Do we feel confident in C, let the power return?
Yes.
It would be awesome if you were all giving her a swerve.
Hold on, I'm sorry, I have to console with her.
All right, I'm going to do this thing, but I'm going to tell you what I do feel with. Everybody say C.
But you have to do it in your He-Man voice.
He-Man.
Let the power return!
what are we giving away? This is our little bit more expensive exclusive. I think for shouting that out, you deserve it. This is Rotar and Twistoid. Along with all the little tributes right there. So again, don't ever open that. Don't ever open that. Yeah, there you go. Congratulations. Thanks a lot.
Hold up. I feel bad. We made you perform as well. You were the hero we need. You also get a Creo G.I. Joe.
With you guys.
Oh my gosh. All right, so here's what we're going to do then. I want to wrap it up. We have one more announcement before we go. But, Derryl, for you, why does G.I. Joe live on? Why does it continue? You know what I mean?
Wow, that's a huge question. I think, well, it's because of you, the fans, that G.I. Joe lives on. It's, you know, it was an amazing toy. It shaped our lives. And, you know, you guys have never let it go. And you're the reason why we relaunched the whole, you know, Joe Cobra story. It was, you know, it was too powerful, its time had come. And, you know, I feel like I was in the right place at the right time to help make that happen, but it wouldn't have happened if you guys weren't the vocal fans to make sure that Hasbro knew. Thank you.
Mark, same question. Why does Masters of the Universe still ring true to us? Why do I care so much about He-Man still? Because I do.
I think it's timeless. I think we were of the right age to sort of have this wish fulfillment of just being able to turn into this very, very powerful character and be able to defeat evil. And it's a timeless trope that I think will continue to live on. But to see it in that form, it's the same answer. It's the fans. You know, you guys have always demanded that we continue to make these toys, and we will continue to make these toys as long as you still want them. So I thank you for keeping it alive.
Thank you all. Again.
Watch yourself, buddy.
Oh, Josh. I have a question from the audience.
All right.
It's a two-parter, and it's all on you.
No pressure.
They want to know, who's your favorite Joe, and who's your favorite He-Man villain? No pressure, just the guy sitting next to you,
you
know. Yeah.
I was all about Duke. Like, Joe was my town. My brother was Snake Eyes, and I was Duke, and that was our matchup in my house. But through working on it, I was telling Derryl earlier, I was never a big fan of Cobra. Like, he was the bad guy. I wanted to be the good guy, of course. But through working with it, looking into the toys more, I actually became a really big fan. I like playing Cobra in the game more than the other guys. So I got turned throughout the toy soldier development. And for He-Man, I was a poor child, so I only ever had He-Man when I was growing up. So like I didn't even have Skeletor and the other guys. I was all about He-Man. So for me, it was like, yeah, I guess, you know, it was He-Man versus G.I. Joe. There wasn't a bad guy.
He-Man's like, stop hitting me! Destroy you all!
Give me a stuff, bro.
Our second and final question comes from Nick. It says, Greg is a stupid head cop. No, that's not a question. We're not gonna read that one. So here's the you laughing it up? Our final thing, our final announcement, ladies and gentlemen, is of course that this game, which you all have supported, made happen, comes out August 11th. There's a special teaser trailer they're gonna make for it. It's gonna be stop motion, the action figures walking around doing things. We have a teaser for it. I don't know if you want to see it. Do you want to see it? Woo! I can't believe it would be a stop motion action figure trailer. It would be totally awesome. But let's see.
This summer, legendary heroes come to life.
Please give a round of applause. You're awesome. Derryl, Mark, Josh, check them all out. They're all over Comic-Con. Go buy exclusives. Get your pets paid and neutered. I'm Greg Miller.